you know, we haven't been with each other here for a few weeks, so we're going to try to go through this and then hopefully get back on track. We're not going to do it justice, obviously, but we're going to do our best in terms of the context of what we're trying to study, looking at the Old Testament simplified, as Rob Whitaker has put these lessons together, and then we'll be able to, Lord willing, move on next week, looking at 1st and 2nd Chronicles. But let's kind of get an overview of what these lessons are really all about. Let's start off just kind of to get our heads wrapped around the benefit of these books. Let's look at Psalm 133. Psalm 133. Notice there what the psalmist writes in verse 1. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. How good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. What does unity bring about in terms of one's life? In terms of one's well-being, in terms of one's emotional, physical conveniences and capabilities. Just think about unity for a second, just generally, and the value of unity. Think about it regarding just our way of life. We have unity in terms of our laws, right? Generally speaking, day-to-day speaking. Obviously, there's complexities as we go deeper and from a policy perspective, but think about roads, for example. Drive out on this road and you want to go to Atlanta, for example. If you are licensed, there's no question in terms of what is required. Why? Because there's unity. This street doesn't say they have a set of laws and you're expected to do this and that and the other. And then it changes as you go from street to street or maybe even from mile to mile. There's unity, and so therefore, what does that mean? That means there's efficiency and there's capability regarding transportation and just your ability to get around. You think about, just from an emotional perspective, the blessing of unity. Just think about a family, for example, and what it means when a family is unified. What are we doing? What is our effort going toward? What are our goals? What are we aspiring toward? Why are we doing what we're doing? How are we going to do what we're going to do? And you think about when there's unity in place and there's alignment and there's understanding, the level of peace and serenity and comfort that comes with that as compared to when there's division. A whole lot of conflict and difficulty, and sometimes it can feel hard to even put one foot in front of another. It can feel as though you're in quicksand and you're going nowhere. You're spinning your wheels, and it's just painful almost to endure from an emotional perspective. What we see when we look at 1st and 2nd Kings is we see the point in which God's people went from being united to then being divided. And the consequences of that, the reason as to why that came about, and the difficulties that then ensued. And so again, remember why we're studying the Old Testament, the value of the Old Testament from those of us who are in the Christian dispensation, which all of us now are. We study the Bible because the Old Testament specifically, because as we do so, what do we grow in? We grow in wisdom as it relates to salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Salvation is in one place, it is in Jesus Christ. And as we study the Old Testament, we grow in our wisdom, meaning we grow in our fear of God, knowing that He is in control, and that regardless of what happens throughout the history of mankind, ultimately, God is going to rule and provide salvation to mankind through Jesus Christ. Again, if you think about the election coming up, 2024, as you think about the political strife and the continual drama that unfolds back and forth before our very eyes, we can take comfort and peace stepping back and realizing, you know what? God is in control. Salvation is in Jesus Christ. All is going to be okay. And so there's some major takeaways in these two books that we can consider. And again, we're not doing this, you know, proper, full, exhaustive study like we probably would like to. We're going to try to just get back on track here. So let's think about 1 and 2 Kings. We find the importance of faithfulness to God and the fact that God expects it. I think about, and if you think about 1 and 2 Kings, you're going to get into the minor prophets, the time period of the minor prophets, contemporary. Many of the prophets throughout the 1 and 2 Kings book. And you think about what Steve provided to us a few studies ago concerning the minor prophets. And what did we constantly remind ourselves of? Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 34, righteousness exalteth a nation, sin is a reproach to any people. Well, you find that here throughout these books. You find God's people going astray, and when they became unfaithful, there were consequences to that unfaithfulness. And again, none of this is a surprise if you look at the books we've even already studied. You think about what Moses prophesied of in the book of Deuteronomy. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 17. Deuteronomy chapter 17, and notice there verse 17. This is guidelines regarding a king for Israel. God there, actually let's read, if someone could for me, verses 14 through 17 of Deuteronomy 17. Deuteronomy 17, 14 through 17.
Thou art coming to the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt possess it, shalt dwell therein, shalt say, I will set a king over me, that all the nations will have come. Thou shalt in any wise set him king over thee, whom the Lord thy God shall choose. One from among thy brethren, thou shalt set king over thee. Thou mayest set a stranger over thee, which is not thy brother. But he shall not multiply horses for himself, nor cause people to return to Egypt, to the end that he would multiply horses. For as much as the Lord hath said unto you, he shall henceforth return no more to that country. Neither shall he multiply wives for himself, that his heart turn not away. Neither shall he greatly multiply.
All right, thank you, brother. And so we come to 1 Kings, and we come to the reign of Solomon, and we look at 1 Kings chapter 11, and we notice there, starting in verse 1, but King Solomon loved many strange women. And you notice there then, verse 3, and he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. Exactly as God had said would happen, is now happening. And so Solomon, in his rule, is not living faithfully to his office, and there are consequences to such. Let's look also, going back to Deuteronomy, chapter 28. Deuteronomy chapter 28, and let's look there at verse 25. Beginning, the Lord shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemies. Thou shalt go out one way against them and flee seven ways before them, and shalt be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth, and thy carcass shall be meat unto all fowls of the air and unto the beasts of the earth, and no man shall pray them away. The Lord will smite thee with the botch of Egypt, and with the emeralds, and with the scab, and with the itch, whereof thou canst not be healed. The Lord shall smite thee with madness and blindness and astonishment of heart. And the reason for this is because of their disobedience. If they were going to disobey, if they were not going to hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, note verse 15, then God was going to curse them, and they would be taken into captivity. And so you go then to 2 Kings chapter 17. Kings chapter 17, looking there, starting at verse 5. And you see then the king of Assyria came up throughout all the land and went up to Samaria and besieged it 3 years. You also notice there in verse 20 of the same chapter, and the Lord rejected all the seed of Israel and afflicted them and delivered them into the hand of the spoilers until he had cast them out of his sight. Then you go to chapter 20 and notice in verse 17, 2 Kings chapter 20 and verse 17. behold, the days come that all that is in thine house and that which thy fathers have laid up in store unto this day shall be carried into Babylon. Nothing shall be left, saith the Lord. And so you have Assyrian captivity and Babylonian captivity taking place because of their unfaithfulness, their failure to hearken unto the voice of the Lord exactly as God had prophesied through the pen of Moses in the book of Deuteronomy. And so what are we learning in these books? We're learning that faithfulness to God is expected. And a nation that does not pursue righteousness, well, that nation is not going to be exalted. That nation is going to be punished. It's going to suffer. Faithfulness to God is expected. We also learn the importance of unity and being faithful to God, being unified in faithfulness to God, and the importance and the consequences of division, and division that occurs as it relates to unfaithfulness. And we get this picture very quickly in this correspondence. Look, for example, at 1 Kings chapter 12, and what we see regarding Jeroboam. What does Jeroboam do? Let's look at this passage. Someone can read for me there, verses 25 through 33. 1 Kings chapter 12, 25 through 33.
Jeroboam built a mountain of peace and welfare. Also, he went out to the air and built a new one. Jeroboam said to his heart, the kingdom may return to house of David. People go up, walk and sacrifice to the house of the Lord and Jerusalem. Part of the people, come back to Jeroboam and Judah. They will kill me, but back to Jeroboam. Therefore, the king asked advice, and the chief man of Israel said to him, it is too much to be there in Jerusalem. Fear on your God, for he brought you up to the land of Egypt. He set one up in Bethel, another he set in Bethel. Now this thing became a sin. The people went to worship for the one who brought his hand. And they climbed on the high place, and the priest never passed. Jeroboam ordered a feast on the 15th day and offered sacrifices to the altar. He made seven sacrifices to the calves and the graves. And Bethel installed priests in the high place. And he made offerings on the altar to the day of Bethel on the 15th day of the week. He had devised his own heart. He ordained a feast of children of Israel, offered sacrifices, and altars and burnt.
All right, and so this is the turning point, right? This is where you have, well, we'll go back. This may not actually be the official, initial turning point, but it is from the sense of, action being taken, the consequence of this, or what led to this, rather, is also of interest, which we'll look at here in a moment. But obviously, division now begins, and it begins with lies, it begins with a deviation from truth, it begins with, quote, half-truths. They're not half-truths, no such thing, it's either a lie or true, but in other words, we're going to do quasi what God wants, but not really. And this begins the problem that God's people have to deal with. Jesus prayed concerning unity, and we find in his prayer in John chapter 17, starting there in verse 20, he says, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And so unity in God's law glorifies him and then is attractive to those that are not right with God. And division causes then confusion. And you have the start of that here with home. And so let's look at how this even came about. So again, 1st and 2nd Kings, we see faithfulness to God as expected. We see unity and faithfulness, division and unfaithfulness. We also see good leadership and bad leadership. Obviously, Israel had nothing but bad kings. Judah had both good and bad kings. Southern Kingdom had some good kings, but they also had their share of bad kings. But let's take a look here at what started this division. And let's look at just the lack of wisdom, the lack of leadership there in the beginning verses of 1 Kings chapter 12. So let's look at 1 Kings chapter 12. It's almost brief, only verses 6 through 17. 1 Kings chapter 12, 6 through 17.
King Rehoboam consulted with the old men that stood before Solomon his father while he yet lived, and said, "How do ye advise that I may answer the people?" And they spake unto him, saying, "Thou wilt be a servant unto this people this day, and wilt serve them, and answer them, speak good words to them, and they will be thy servants forever." But he forsook the counsel of the old men that they had given him, and consulted with the young men that were grown up with him, which stood before him. And he said unto them, "What counsel give ye that we may answer the people who have spoken to me, saying, Take the yoke which thy father put unto the fighter. And the young men that were grown up with him spake unto him, saying, Thus shalt thou speak unto the people, spake unto thee, saying, Thy father may our yoke heavy, but make thou it lighter unto us. Thus shalt unto them, My little finger shall be thicker than my father's loin. And now, whereas my father has weighed you with a heavy yoke, I will add to your yoke. My father has chastised you with whips, but I will chastise you with scorpions." So Jeroboam and all the people came to Rehoboam the third day, as the king had appointed. Come to me again the third day. He answered the people roughly, took the old men's counsel to the table, and spake to them as the counsel of the young men, saying, "My father made your yoke heavy, and I will add to your yoke. My father also chastised you with whips, I will chastise you with scorpions. Wherefore the king hearkened not unto the people, for the cause was from the Lord, that he might perform his saying, which the Lord spake to Ahijah the Shilonite, and Jeroboam, son of Nebat. So when all Israel saw that the king hearkened not unto them, the people answered the king, saying, What portion have we in David? Neither have we inheritance in the son of Jesse, to your tent, O Israel. Now feast in thine own house, David. So Israel departed unto their tent. As for the children of Israel which dwelt in the cities of Judah, Rehoboam and Jeroboam.
All right, thank you, brother. So again, just generally poor leadership, and obviously Jeroboam is departing the law of God, as we saw earlier. He does so by setting up idolatrous locations. He makes two calves. He sets one up in Bethel, one in Dan. Hey, it's easier to go here rather than go to Jerusalem, not wanting to lose power, not wanting to lose influence, and replacing worship to God with idolatry. He's setting up an alternative priesthood, not from the sons of Levi, note verse 31 of 1 Kings 12. And then he also alters the way in which God has commanded worship to take place and sacrifice to take place. You notice there in verse 32, and you compare that to what was commanded in Leviticus chapter 23, verses 41 through 43. 41, you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord for 7 days in the year. It shall be a statute forever in your generation. You shall celebrate it in the seventh month, not the eighth, verse 32 of 1 Kings 12. You shall dwell in booths for 7 days. All who are native Israelites shall dwell in booths, that your generation may know that I made the children of Israel dwell in booths when I brought them out of the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. And so he altered this, he changed this. Again, it was similar, but it was not according to the commandments of God. And where did he get it all? Verse 33, from his own heart. He innovated. He created his own system. There's lots of parallels that we could make today. There's lots of application here, obviously. I'm sure we've heard several sermons from Jeroboam's sins and the justification here that man comes up with regarding how things can be done differently or, quote, better. But ultimately, God's law is being departed. And so here's kind of the major, I think, benefit concerning these books. And then we'll circle back to good and bad leadership in just a moment. But think about the way in which this narrative is set up. Think about the historical record that we gain regarding the kingdom united and the kingdom divided. Think about the tone and the way it is presented. If you read 1 Kings chapter 12, who won that battle in terms of the narrative? Rehoboam get painted in a positive light? No. Does Jeroboam get painted in a positive light? No. That in and of itself is fascinating. For example, if you look at the history of China, just have fun for a day and go down some rabbit trails and try to Wikipedia an understanding of the history of China. You're going to walk away from it. There's just a general lack of record keeping and consensus in terms of how China came about to be what it is now today. Why is that? Well, because there were multiple parties and multiple moments of power, and throughout that process, what do you think occurred? History was muddied. It was unclear in terms of the narrative as to what really happened. Okay? Now, compare that to, for example, colonial history. If you look at colonial history, what do you really walk away with? You walk away with the thought that there was an absolute record as to what occurred. And there was also some moral authority behind what happened. There was a right and a wrong. There was a good and there was a bad. And I'm not arguing whether or not that was the case. I'm just saying that's the takeaway you get when you look at colonial history. In other words, European history and American history. When you look at this account, okay, it's not unclear. It's not muddy. It's not confusing. But at the same time, it's not absolute from a moral perspective that there is one right and one wrong. Unless you look at it from the perspective of God versus man. And it is very clear who is telling this story. It is very clear who is providing the account and the record as to what occurred and what went wrong and who failed. And God doesn't hold back. And that in and of itself is a fascinating takeaway. First and Second Kings, in many respects, is validation that the Bible has been authored by God. I know we're studying that in our sermon material, and we're looking at that from an evidence perspective. Is the Bible God's word? But you take that away looking at the Old Testament, and remember what we're doing in studying the Old Testament. We're growing in wisdom that salvation comes through Jesus Christ. We're growing in our understanding, in our fear that God is in control. When you look at 1 and 2 Kings, you get that takeaway. Who do you think would have wanted to alter the way in which just 1 Kings chapter 12 was written? You think Jeroboam would have wanted to do that? Absolutely. What does it say? What he did was sin. Crystal clear. You think Rehoboam would have wanted to alter the way in which 1 Kings chapter 12 was written? Absolutely. What do you take away from that? Rehoboam was a fool. He failed to hearken to the wise counsel of his older, eldest advisor. The narrative and the historical record of these books are of value and help us grow in our fear and our wisdom regarding God and His plan for salvation. I really wanted to go through Josiah, for example, 2 Kings chapter 23. Obviously, Josiah is a great leader and a great example here, and there's lots to look at regarding the kings of Judah. You have good kings, you have bad kings, you have amazing situations where, based on the choice of the king, rule happens either faithfully to God or unfaithfully. And that's a blessing for parents raising children. That's a blessing for children being raised by parents. Regardless of how that all comes out, ultimately, we have choice. And you take, for example, Josiah, and you see great leadership. Of course, 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 25, like unto him was there no king before him that turned to the Lord with all his heart, with all his soul, and with all his might. The whole being of Josiah seeking to rule faithfully to God according to all the law of Moses. Neither after him arose there any question. Any other comments or thoughts here? First and second. Thank you all very much.